Hi, I'm Bill Hodges, and this is Spotlight on Tampa Bay. And I am so excited today because we have the brand new county commissioner, Kevin Bechner. Kevin, it's so great to have you on the program.
It's great to be here, Bill. Thank you.
I have such great hopes for you. I don't know if you'll be able to live up for all the expectations I have of you, but everything I've read, everything I've seen, everything you've talked about, I seem to be in step with, so that must make you a pretty intelligent person.
Well, thank you. I really appreciate that, and I think over time, I think we'll figure that out. We got certainly a lot of work to do here in the county, and we've got a lot of issues that are going to be coming before us. So, working together, I think we'll make great strides in this community.
It is going to be a critical time in the community. There's no doubt about it. But let's go into who is Kevin Bechner. Where did you come from? What education do you have? What are those?
I was born and raised in Michigan City, Indiana, and I've been in the Tampa Bay community now for about 10 years, and I'm a former police officer and currently a police officer and currently a certified financial planner.
That's a jump.
You know, it really pretty much it is. You know, when I moved down here and decided to had a music company, decided no longer to be to have the music company, and it was sold off. Then decided to get into financial planning. It was a natural transition for me because coming out of college, I put together a life plan and had a financial advisor help me with that. And so,
oh, really?
So once I decided to make a transition, it was kind of a natural transition of doing something that I absolutely believed in.
Okay, you had some natural transitions, but one thing I always ask anybody who ran for public office, why did you do that to yourself?
Well, you know what, Bill? It's you come to a point in your life when you take a look at what's going on in your community, and it seems like so many people complain on the sidelines about what their government is doing or not doing, and I was one of those individuals. So I just decided, there came a point in my life where I decided, you know, I'm tired of complaining.
Put up or shut up, right?
Exactly. So I wanted to use my talents and my abilities to make a real difference in our community. And so as I met with political consultants and I met with other community leaders, they said, Kevin, if you really wanted to have a influence on what's happening in Hillsborough County, you need to hold public office. So we talked about running for the Hillsborough County Commission. And then in January 2007, we announced our candidacy, and for 22 months, ran a totally grassroots campaign.
Wow, 22 months.
22 months, yeah.
You know, and you're a reasonably young person. What do you say to other young people about getting involved? Because that's the segment, evidently, one of the big segments that put Obama in office.
Well, I'm glad that you mentioned that because, as I tell everybody, whether you're younger or more seasoned, it's really important that you get involved with your local community, especially on the political level. You know, so many times, especially when it comes around to election time, we get really excited about electing a president, but sometimes we don't always get involved on what's happening here locally.
School board, right.
Well, exactly. And it's the local elected leaders that really have the greatest influence on your quality of life. And so I tell people, you really need to get involved.
Well, you were very good at working with the internet too.
Internet was
that's what Obama was known for, was that grassroots campaign with the internet, but you did the same thing.
Well, absolutely. You know, when I got into this campaign, I had no political agenda. The only thing that I was focused on was reconnecting the priorities of government back with the priorities of the people. And so we used a multitude of different mediums, everything from the shoe leather, you know, going door to door, to going out to civic associations, going out to different community events, and then using electronic internet technology to, again, help reconnect people and to bring people together.
What do you think was the hardest thing about the campaign, besides raising money, which I assume has got to be a horrible thing?
Well, you know, it is, but, you know, I look at it when somebody gives you a campaign contribution, it's about investing back into the community. And, you know, as we took in campaign contributions, you know, we had nearly 1,700 contributions come in, and they were all from individuals and small businesses, people that really wanted to, again, invest back in the community and really wanted to make a difference. And that's one way you can make a difference, is through financial support. You know, we had people that also volunteered countless hours. We had nearly 400 volunteers on the ground.
400?
Nearly 400 volunteers.
That speaks well of you to get that many people together to do anything.
Well, I think a lot was a combination of things. things. You know, as people that were really ready for a change and people, again, that really wanted to make a real difference in our community, we all came together and focused on one common goal, and that was, again, to get elected to public office.
When you first started this, have your views changed at all about what's possible and what's not possible?
Actually, no. I leave the whole doors open to that. I believe that anything's possible when we focus on it. And I have to say, you know, I've been in office now for about a month, and my fellow commissioners, they've been very congenial. The staff has been congenial. And it seems like right at this point, we have a really good working relationship, and we really, seems like we're coming together to get things accomplished for our community. So it's been a great gratifying experience so far.
I think it was interesting that the number of people was a record number of people that came to see you be sworn in.
That was an amazing, amazing time, you know, and it was very emotional for me as well because so many people came together to make that happen and to see that type of support. It was very touching and moving for me.
You have 400 people that are on the ground helping you, not to mention all their peripherals, their mothers, their fathers, their cousins, and whatever. It's got to be a real problem because I couldn't remember that many people.
Well, you know, it's challenging, but like I said, this is how we came together. You know, sometimes, you know, it was through word of mouth. Again, people were just coming together, and everybody was focusing on one common cause. And, you know, it was a great, great experience, and it was great to see the community come together in this fashion.
I really like the fact that you maintained a fairly positive campaign. You know, when I say fairly positive, because you tell that somebody did something that they really did do is not being negative, it's just stating the fact.
Well, going throughout the campaign, you know, we focused on Mr. Blair's public service record. And, you know, unfortunate for him, there's a lot of inconvenient truths that, you know, certainly weren't comfortable talking about. But, you know, the facts are the facts. It is what it is. And that's what we focused on through the campaign. And, you know, November 4th was, in essence, Judgment Day. And those people in government leaders, when they're elected to office, they need to be held accountable for their actions or their inactions. As I will in 4 years, people will judge me on what I have done or have not done. And I expect to be held accountable for my actions.
Well, certainly Mr. Blair was no friend to the public's ability to get out there and speak, because he was one of the ones that decided to take the tax money that's being paid to keep the station open and use it for other things that were his pet projects.
Well, you know, and I'm a big believer in public access. You know, I believe in the voice of the people. I think this is one medium where people's voice can be heard. And so, you know, we are going to be in extraordinarily tight budget times. But, you know, again, I really think that whatever we can do to help the, you know, to continue to provide the a medium for the people, I think we need to make sure that we do that as a government entity.
Well, I would like to see the rest of Hillsborough County be able to use this facility. That's the thing that really, we want to go cover a parade in Plant City or something, and we can't do it.
No, and then, like I said,
sad.
It really is, because once again, I think when you take a look at the freedom of speech issues and take a look at people's ability to be able to have their voice heard, I think there's no better medium than a facility like this.
What do you see in the early meetings that you're having with the other commissioners as far as what's going to happen here in this county?
Well, I think one thing is very clear that we're all well aware of. While we have not received the actual figures for the budget, we know that this year is going to be extraordinarily, extraordinarily, extraordinarily tight money-wise. And so what really that means is that we're going to really have to become laser-focused on what we're going to be spending the tax dollars on. And that's why it's so important for people to get involved and have their voice heard. It's important for them to come out to the public meetings, to the commission meetings, to let us know what your priorities are as far as services go, because inevitably some things are going to have to be scaled back and tough choices are going to have to be made. So, but that's why it's so important that people get involved. So we know that is going to be, again, very, very clear from us going forward.
You have a specific plan, correct, for doing that and getting out and talking to people?
One of the things that we're focused on, and part of that I mentioned through the campaign, that I've often heard is sometimes that people don't feel like their voice is heard in government. And one of the things we're starting in January, it's called a Coffee with Kevin. So for four Saturdays in January, we will be at each in the strategic place in each one of the districts. And then that will be for an informal meet and greet with, so the public can meet myself. And then throughout the year, we will have, at the end of the month, we will have an opportunity in each district once a month where people will be able to come and view their opinions and express their concerns to me in open office hours. So they don't have to have an appointment. They just come in, they sign in, they'll be able to tell me what their issues are. And again, we'll have that throughout the entire year.
Well, let's go back to the coffees. Now, are you looking to do this in large forums or in people's homes, or how are you going to handle this? And the other aspect of this is who within your staff will be handling this in order to set it up?
Well, right now we are looking at public venues because we operate in Sunshine, and although we're not and we don't have the commission together, it's going to be in a public venue, and we are still determining what those venues are. I've got two great staff people, Jerry Nolan and Mark Nash, that are coordinating that. And so, and like I said, once
Mark's a great guy.
Yes,
I don't know the other one, but I do Mark.
Well, Mark's been fantastic. He's my field director, and let me tell you, the work that he put in the campaign, and certainly the work that he is putting into providing the services and the needs for our office so we can serve the people has been tremendous. Jerry Nolan was a former aide to Commissioner Jan Platt, and so she has a lot of experience.
That's good reference right there. I love Jan.
Yes, yeah. So, like I said, great staff will help facilitate to put this together.
So, are you looking for venues, churches, places that you can do this at? If somebody wanted to call you and say, gee, we'd really like to have one in our area, you come to our church, or how do you want to handle it?
Well, throughout the for the January programs, that's what we'll be focusing on. And again, if somebody wants to contact my office with a idea for a venue, that would be fantastic. We're looking for things that are more centrally located and accessible to people in each of the different districts. Then when it comes to the monthly meetings, then those will be more probably towards the public library venues.
Do you know if you're coming out to Sun City Center? If you've got a
We will definitely be
something set up out there.
We will definitely be down in that area. Like I said, we're not exactly sure. And we will be hitting each district three times throughout the year. So there'll be a total of three meetings in each district. So we'll vary it via time and also location to make sure that we again have as much access opportunities for people as possible.
How do you feel about, let's say that I'm president of such and such group and I'd like to have you come out and speak? Are you willing to do that on a space available basis, to time available?
Oh, absolutely. They can contact my office at 813-272-5730. And, obviously the more advanced notice given is possible. But again, I want to make myself as accessible as possible to the community so people, again, we can open up the doors and the voice for government.
Well, this is a very big county, and you ran at large. So it really, you've got the whole county to be responsible to.
That's correct. Just so that people are aware, there's actually seven county commissioners, there's four individual district commissioners, and then three at-large. And I chose to run for the at-large seat because I wanted to focus more on the global county issues, things like transportation, talking about balancing growth with the environment, job growth, economic development. While the other commissioners, my role is also to support them to help get their initiatives and their individual districts taken care of as well. But anybody can contact my office, and like I said, that's what we're here for.
Anybody know how far it is? I guess I should look at a map sometime to go from the corner of Hillsborough up by Pinellas County all the way down to the far corner by Manatee. It's got to be a long ways.
It's a very big county, Bill, and I learned this firsthand because when we were campaigning, in the middle of the campaign back in July 2007. I live up in the Citrus Park area, and so I drove from there to the near border of Brandon, and it was 54 miles one way.
Really?
So that started to give me some idea, how large this county really is.
Got to be another 30 or 40 miles that way. So it's got to be close to 100 miles from one corner to the other.
Yeah, when you take a look at it,
and there's no easy way to get there.
No, we are the fourth largest state or county in the state. We have nearly 1.2 million people, And it's really interesting. We have over 700,000 registered voters, and it's interesting that, we are larger than some states as far as voter registration and in people population.
People vote here.
Oh, yes, they do.
They do a very good job. You know, one of the things you mentioned about your background that's got to be a real benefit to the taxpayer today is financial planning, because government has become bloated. If you just look at the number of employees in the year 2000, and you look at the number of employees here in 2009, there's been a tremendous increase in the size of government.
Oh, absolutely. And I think my background will be beneficial, especially, like I said, we're going to be running into some very difficult, tight budget times. And so I'm a planner by trade. It's what I've been doing for the for nearly the last 10 years. And so we absolutely must plan and put together a comprehensive plan for our future. And it's really challenging when you're talking about the size of this government, what we're dealing with, the number of services. So it's going to be a plan in the works. But like I said, that's what we've been focusing on, is trying to get some direction. But you're absolutely right. You know, going forward, you know, planning and around especially the use of taxpayers' dollars are going to be crucial.
Well, Pat Bean was on this program, and she mentioned the size of the Hillsborough budget. And I know there are third world countries that just don't have that much money.
Yeah, we're nearly $4 billion, and that's with the B. So it's a fairly large budget to deal with. And like I said, this is a large county. There's a lot of you know, services, especially when it comes to security here that we have to deal with. So yeah, it's a big beast.
I think years ago they talked about $1 billion. Somebody said if you stood on the top of a building and you dropped $1 bills at a certain income, I forget what it was, you'd never drop the full billion.
I don't doubt that.
And I've never been able to comprehend $1 billion. That's more than I get my arms around. And yet, four of them just for this county.
Yep, that's right. That's right. It's like I said, the magnitude of it is very large, but at the same point in time, you know, I think we have a great board, and certainly with the public input, that's like I said, it's extraordinarily important that the public continue to give us their input as far as how their dollars should be spent.
What do you think, besides being aware of the budget, which is probably the most important thing that everybody's got to do right now,
sure,
and the economy? But what do you think are the things, infrastructure-wise, that would be the most important things? You talked about transportation and some of the others. What do you see as the more important things that the BOCC has to look at, not only for today, but for the future?
Well, absolutely. That's a great question. What I look at, especially when we're looking at our economy, we're looking at our community as a whole, the community is built on a few different things that are important. Number one, it has to do, obviously, with jobs. And so having good-paying jobs here in our community is important. And then you take a look at affordable housing. Housing has to be affordable in a community for people to want to stay here and also to move here. And then put that in together, transportation is an extraordinarily important part of not only for the residents that live here, but for economic development in the future. And then you put around, you take a look at other issues that are important, like cultural diversity and making sure that we have an inclusive community. That all makes for a successful community. So those are some of the big, larger scope pictured issues that we're going to be focusing on.
Well, you have really touched on some sore spots there. Affordable housing.
Mm-hmm.
Housing is a lot more affordable today than it was a few years ago, but we owned a home in Apollo Beach, which has now been sold. But before we sold it, we couldn't afford to rent it.
Right.
Because our payment was higher than any reasonable rent we could have got from it. And I believe there's got to be a lot of rental properties in that same situation. How do we go towards affordable housing?
It's really important when we take a look at affordable housing that we have options for people. You had mentioned rentals. That's certainly an important part. But also, again, you know, we take a look at the median income and as far as what a home is selling for. While it has decreased over the last couple of years at a good pace, it is still not keeping up in pace with the median income in our county. So again, it's really working with some of the smart developers, and again, making sure that we have affordable housing that is available, that's of a variety for price ranges that people can afford, and then of course balancing that type of growth with our environmental needs.
What do you see transportation-wise?
It's important that we have a complete transportation plan. We're looking at the option of mass transit, I think is very important. We are the last of the major metropolitan communities to develop a complete mass transit plan that needs to be addressed not only on a local level, but also a regional level. And with that, we have to couple local transportation. So working with Heartline and making sure that once we have a transportation system in place, that's mass transit, that we have the bus systems, integrated bus systems, rapid bus systems, transit systems in place to be able to get people from point A to point B. So I like to address regional transportation from a mass transportation on a larger scale regional level and then bring it back home locally.
Well, you know, it's early in your career on the BOCC, but I'm sure given your interest in transportation, and the fact that the federal government is going to start with, under President Obama, is going to be start on these self-help projects, wouldn't now be a really good time to have a something in the box that we could present to the federal government for getting us mass transit?
Well, that's a great point, because this is the main issue. Without having that plan in place, we aren't even in line.
That's it.
we met with Representative Micah that came in, and he heads the part of the Transportation Committee in Congress. And what we're talking about was, without a plan in place, we are not even in line to receive federal dollars. That's why he's encouraging getting the plan in place and getting us organized so we can get in line to receive those federal dollars is going to be important, because we're going to need the federal dollars, we're going to need state dollars, as well as local dollars to help pay for transportation.
I just don't think we can pave over America. I don't think we can keep putting highways in. And with gas going to $4 a gallon, and don't forget, it did go to $4 a gallon. If you forget it, like we did in 73, it'll be another 30 years and it'll be $10 a gallon. We've got to do things that are green and that allow us to break our love affair with automobiles, and light rail seems to me to be an alternative.
It is, and I'm glad you brought up that point, because if we continue to only build more roads, it's not the final solution. It's just a band-aid to fix the problem. It's an expensive one as well. We've got to be able to have more alternatives to get the automobiles off the road. And so when we're talking about complete transportation for the people that live in the municipalities and the cities, having safe bicycle paths and things like that are going to be really important. Again, more options to get people off the road. We certainly can't continue to just build more roads. It's not the answer to transportation.
You know, out in Sun City Center, we get to use our golf carts all over the area, which are really kind of fabulous.
Sure.
My car sits in the garage, and we use it to do our shopping, run to the doctor, do the various errands we have to run every day. We do it in a golf cart, plug it into a wall.
Yep. You know, that's, again, another mode of transportation. And so transportation is going to be one of the keys, again, for not just people that live here now, but to be able to attract more high-paying jobs into the area, and for economic growth and development is going to be very key.
Well, commuting, if people are having to commute and they're in traffic jams a good share of their day going in and out, they're not going to come here.
Well, that's right.
And also, I can go to Atlanta and ride MARTA.
Well, it's been one of the inhibiting factors of, again, attracting more people into this area, and as well as other industries to come here. When they look at the infrastructure that we have in place, it's inadequate. You take a look at also from an economic standpoint, being able to track venues, for instance, like the Super Bowl. I think we're very blessed to have events come here like that. For the economy, it's extraordinary. We're supposed to generate anywhere between $100 to $200 million from that. To be able to track more events like that, we have to be able to manage the flow of the transportation
people.
And move people.
I said at the beginning that I was going to give you 1 or 2 minutes to just talk with our audience and tell them about your hopes and dreams and what you would like to see for Hillsborough County during this first of your tours of duty as a county commissioner. So why don't you do that this time? Just go ahead and talk to the people and let them know what you think.
Great. Thanks, Bill. What people need to realize, and I hope you realize out there, is that I'm very proud and honored to be your Hillsborough County Commissioner, and I want to thank each and every one of you for helping me get elected to office. But getting me elected to office is not the end. It's just the beginning for this county. What I need your help with is again, getting involved with our government. I want you to make sure that you're coming to our community meetings, that you're getting actively involved in the process here. Because, again, these are your tax dollars. This is your community. So if you want to make this a better place, I'm here to help you make your dreams and aspirations come true, but I need your help to do that. So what I'm encouraging you to do is to, again, come to the county commission meetings, come to our budgeting workshops, come to our forums, and if you would like to meet me personally, you can call me on the telephone at 813-272-5730. I would be happy to speak with you in any way that I can, again, to work with you to make sure that this Hillsborough County is a better community for all people.
So we're not just talking to big contributors, we're saying everybody has access to you, right?
This is the people's county, absolutely.
And I think that's so important because, you know, as you've seen in Illinois, government is for sale.
Well, I would like to think that it's not for sale here. And I think when we're electing responsible people to office and people that are committed to the community, that won't be the case. But again, that's why it's so important, again, that you get involved in the local level and that you get involved with local politics in your community.
And that's where young people really need to follow your model and get involved.
Absolutely.
As I assume a lot of your campaign was young people.
Well, absolutely. You know, and I really believe that our youth and our children are the future of our community. And we need to continue to invest in them and encourage them to get involved in the process. Because, again, going forward, they're the ones that are going to be leading our future.
Yeah, I think it would be, for me, a mind-boggling task to be one of seven county commissioners, and only three of which have responsibility to the entire county. Not that each of the individual ones don't also, but they at least have to please one small group. You've got to please the whole bunch.
Well, again, what part of our responsibilities, the way I look at it, is where we should be handling and addressing really larger global county issues. And again, supporting the commissioner's endeavors in the individual districts. And let me tell you, it's a lot of work even if you're an individual district because, you know, there's a lot of smaller scale projects and even larger scale projects that you have to address in a district basis. But when we all work together, we can make great things happen.
We just have run out of time. And it's just a shame, but I do want to have you back. Will you come back on the show for us?
Absolutely, Bill.
Give you a few months to get yourself entrenched in the BOCC and then come back and talk to us some more because I'd like to talk to you about the diversity of our community, which is huge. There's so many more other things, but thank you so much for being with me today. I really appreciate your being here. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Bill Hodges, and this has been Kevin Bechter, our newest BOCC member, and I'm looking for great things from Kevin. I hope that you will do as he said, meet with him, hold his feet to the fire, make sure he keeps up what he says he's going to do, because that's the only way we can have a representative government in this particular county or actually in our whole United States of America. Remember, you're unique, you're special, and you're great. Tell yourself so often because you are, you know. We'll see you on the next Spotlight on Tampa Bay. And again, thanks so much for being here. We really appreciate it.
My pleasure, Bill. Thank you.